Hello, friends. This is Mike Williams of the Sage of Quay Radio Hour. I recently had the pleasure of joining Kevin Martin on his podcast, Mind the Gap. I hope you enjoy the discussion.
Hi, my friends. I'm absolutely honored today to be discussing Martin Scorsese's film, George Harrison's Living in a Material World, with Mike Williams, who's otherwise known as the Sage of Quay. And I'm absolutely honored to have Mike here. I've been listening to Mike for years now on interviewing interesting guests and covering subjects a lot of people don't cover. So Mike, I'd be very grateful if you can introduce to the audience, just give a brief description of yourself and what you do and why you chose the film.
Well, first, Kevin, thank you for having me on the show. And as far as myself, I look at myself as a regular guy who started a blog, I guess around 7 years ago, and my YouTube channel, Sage of Quay, is now a little over 4 years old, and just trying to get the truth out, or at the very least, get people to open their minds a little bit and to utilize a little bit more of the critical thinking and the free thinking that they have, so that we can break out of the box and we can free ourselves and unshackle from this matrix system that we live in. With regard to the film Living in the Material World, it is a very long film. I think it's over 3 hours. It's a Martin Scorsese documentary on George Harrison. And the reason why I chose that film for our discussion was because here we have a person, George Harrison. He was thrust into the music industry, which is very controlled by the Matrix, and in a band that is arguably the most popular band in the world, rock and roll band, the Beatles. And George went through this transition, this transformation, if you will, in his life, where he went into the spiritual aspects, into the Eastern religion, into Hinduism. And when he did that, his world opened up. He realized that his world wasn't just the Beatles and it wasn't all of his fame and fortune, that there was a much deeper quality to life. If you watch the film, George actually does a lot of the narrating because he's passed away now, but there's a lot of clips of George speaking about his life and his spiritual journey. It got to the point where he really didn't interact with the music industry at a certain point toward the end because he just saw it for what it was. And he had in his mind better things to do, which was to spend time with his family and his friends and to nurture other things in his life. And I also may add that his music, for me, being a musician myself, it's great. His solo music, for the most part, is very, very good. He had probably a couple of sketchy albums here or there, but he had written some beautiful music. And I don't really think he got the acknowledgments that he probably should have for some of that music. And I'm not talking about the big hits that he had, like What Is Life and songs like that. Just the other tracks on his albums, like Maya Love from his Dark Horse album. It's a brilliant, brilliant song. So that's really why I chose that movie, Kevin, is because here we have a famous person thrust into the mainstream of the Matrix, into the Beast, into one of their controlling mechanisms, the music industry, and a guy that he journeyed his way out of it in a way, and he did it from a spiritual perspective.
And when I watched the film, I found it, there were so many themes in the film. So one of them was this constant battle between conformity and individuality. There was this real sense he had this real deeper search for something else, even though he was in this, you know, people would die to be in this band and be in this in this forefront of this movement in terms of the Beatles. It still wasn't enough for him. And there was always this constant battle for recognition within the Beatles, where he was, you know, faced with a real challenge of Lennon and McCartney.
Yeah, so his creativity was stifled, right? We get that through the film when he's with the Beatles. And so if you're a person who's a creative person, and musicians are creative people, that it becomes very difficult after a while where you feel like you cannot express yourself. You want to express yourself. That's why you play guitar, you play piano, or even if you're a painter or you're a writer, you want to express yourself. And he found himself in a situation where he wasn't able to do that. And that's part of the controlling mechanism of the music industry. They focused on Lennon and McCartney. And it wasn't until much later on in the Beatles, in their existence, that George kind of broke out. And he really broke out in a way with While My Guitar Gently Weeps, on the White Album, and that was in 1968. And of course, the Beatles' first album, Please Please Me, came out in March of 1963. So that's 5 years later. I mean, George had some tracks like Taxman and stuff like that before. But when you take a look at what George was allowed to have on an album relative to what Lennon and McCartney had on their albums, I mean, he was a very small blip on the radar. And it wasn't when Abbey Road came out and he wrote Something and Here Comes the Sun. That was an amazing, I believe, an amazing moment in his life and in his career, because those two songs on Abbey Road, in my view, probably upstaged every other song on Abbey Road, which was a Lennon and McCartney composition. So he came out really on top on the last album.
And do you think that may have been the recognition he needed, the courage it needed for him to break away? I mean, he was a prolific songwriter and, you know, a very, very accomplished musician. If we think of the band, you know, he was the one who taught Lennon how to actually play six string instead of four string in terms of, and I'm not a guitar player, but I sense from you that may be something quite difficult, or another art form, to go to that level of playing.
To go
from a six string to a four string, I don't know how difficult that would be, but I had the sense that he was the one who actually taught Lennon some of the deeper chord sequences and deeper arrangements.
When John first started playing many, many years ago, he actually would play the guitar like a banjo. He would play bell chords. And so, I mean, he evolved from that. George, in my opinion, was a better guitar player than John. I mean, John, by his own admission, will say that he essentially looked at himself as a rhythm guitar player. That was it. And he thought himself a pretty good rhythm guitar player. I did read an interview where John had said that the question to him by the person who was interviewing him was, how come, you know, you're not hanging out with some of these other artists and musicians and joining them up on stage and, you know, just doing impromptu types of gigs and stuff like that? And it was a very interesting response that came back from John. He had said that he didn't have enough self-confidence to do that. And so what he was saying is that he was doubting his own ability as a guitarist to perhaps go up on stage with a guy, let's say like Eric Clapton, who's a great guitar player. Whereas it's very interesting, because all these other guitar players would look at John Lennon as one of the greatest songwriters and musicians that ever existed in rock and roll. Yet, you know, the guy that has that aura about him from other people, he had a self-confidence issue about going on stage and playing with these guys. It's a very, very interesting dynamic when you think about it. And so I do think he learned from George as far as George's guitar techniques. But on the other hand, George would say that, and I don't think he said this in Living in the Material World, but there's plenty of interviews out there over the course of the Beatle history where you can watch this and hear this, where he had said that John was a huge influence on him, because John was kind of like an older brother to him. George was the youngest. Yeah, he was the youngest in the band. So I think there was a give and take there, Kevin. John was kind of a big brother figure to George. But on the other hand, George, in my view, was the better guitar player. And, you know, if you hang around with somebody who is a better musician than you, you are going to definitely start to pick up certain techniques and you'll become better. You always get better when you hang around with people with better skills.
Yeah, totally. And, you know, as us engaging on our quest in terms of trying to find out how to deal with the matrix, talking to like people like yourself and communicating is the way we can all develop. There was a great quote Lennon said where, and there was a common theme throughout the documentary where he said, George, yeah, you love him, but on the other hand, he can be a complete bastard. And there was this sort of dichotomy to him where on one hand, he was this workaholic, really nice person, but there's this other dark side where, you know, he took drugs, he was a womanizer. And there seemed to be like a split to him in sometimes of his personality.
Yeah, that is interesting. And even his wife at one point in the documentary had alluded to the fact, I mean, I think pretty straightforward, I mean, that he liked the ladies, and that's something that she had to deal with, right? It was kind of a very awkward moment during the documentary. Hats off to Martin Scorsese, in my view, for keeping it in there, because it does show this part about George that he had this other side to him. Now, when I watched it, was I disappointed by that? No, because we're humans. This human experience is about having the experience. And so we are going to have our foibles. We are going to have things that we do or say that perhaps when we look back in life, we would say to ourselves, boy, I really wish I hadn't done that, or I really wish I hadn't said that. But that's part of life. And also when you factor in the fact of his notoriety and the fact that he was in the Beatles, just the influx of people reaching out to him, especially the females, I'm sure that it becomes very difficult to behave yourself sometimes, especially when you're a young guy. I mean, you know, he was in his 20s when he's with the Beatles. You know, he was a young 20-year-old guitar player. So I guess it could be a little tough.
And his wife was, you know, she was a gorgeous woman. It didn't really tend to, you know, she was an absolutely gorgeous woman. And then, you know, there's a theme in the film where his early wife, Patty, and Eric Clapton, there's that theme where, you know, Eric Clapton's fallen in with his life, in with his wife. And it's quite interesting because initially George is like, oh, yeah, that's fine, whatever, love, free and peace. And then when it actually dawns on him that they might actually be having a relationship, you get this total extra contrast. He's like, well, I did sort of agree to that. You've got to come to me. So it's really interesting sometimes the way he's portrayed. But I was wondering when you answer, I mean, if you think of the great artists and the great creators of the world, there tends to be a dark side to them. And I wonder what that is and why that manifests itself in terms of that sort of attribute.
I don't know. It's a tough question, but I think that what happens is people, even really good people, sometimes get lured into those aspects of the material world, into the physical world. And it's very tempting. You know, I've had these moments in my own life when I was younger. And I think it would be probably disingenuous for anybody to put themselves out there as just, you know, very pure and not making any of these mistakes in life. I think if they're even considered mistakes, some people might not even consider them mistakes. But, you know, I just think that it's part of the human experience, Kevin. I really do. Now, dark to me is when you're doing harm to other people. You know, you're doing harm and intentional harm. I might add that. But, you know, if you are overindulging in certain things and, you know, but you still have your wits about you and you're able to get yourself back on track, those things happen. And those things happen to most people.
Yeah, and I totally agree. So yeah, I'm glad you sort of reframed the dark aspect because I suppose society sees them as dark aspects, but we all act out in certain ways. And in a way, sometimes when we're overwhelmed or there's an aspect of us, there's a way we'll act out. And he seemed to have a propensity with women. And as you said, he had more access to women than most people can ever imagine.
Right. Right. So maybe we should give him credit for restraining himself.
Yeah. I mean, if you look at Wingo Starr and some of the others, they weren't so restrained.
So, yeah, I don't know. It's what makes that person, right? So that's what made George Harrison. That's what made George Harrison, George Harrison. And, you know, he could be snippy and he could be very cutting with his comments. This is something else that came out in the documentary and also in other material that I have read and watched about George. So, yeah, he did have this kind of this seesaw type of personality. But what I also detected was as he got older, that seesaw wasn't rocking equally back and forth anymore. He definitely went more toward that spiritual journey. And there was this self-maturation, is this process of really growing into the spirituality and becoming very aware of it. As an example, in the documentary, when his home was broken into, and he thought he was going to die, the person that broke into the house was actually sitting on top of him. And the thought that his wife, Olivia, was relaying back to the audience is that George had said to her afterwards that he thought it was over, that he was going to die, and that he had to prepare himself mentally for the fact that this could be it. Because in his religious beliefs, being prepared for your death is going to make the transition or the crossing over much easier versus somebody who dies, let's say, a violent or unexpected death. And what you can read into that is that maybe the transition going from the physical world to the non-physical, crossing over into the spirit world, it might not go as smoothly. And that's what I was gathering from the film. So here you have a guy who's under extreme duress during that time when he's being attacked, having the fortitude to bring himself back in and to say, okay, so I've got to do certain things here, because if this doesn't go well, I have to be prepared to make the transition to the next step, into my next existence. And so he was very fluid about that, which I found kind of interesting, because I think most people that were being attacked probably wouldn't be having that thought process in their mind. I don't know. I'm just saying, you know. So this just says something about his spiritual discipline. That's my point.
Yeah, a very high level of consciousness to be able to think, you know, if I go out maybe violently protecting myself, on the other side, that's going to manifest itself. And I think his wife, Olivia, talked about when he died, and she described it as this great light or experience of you could see the transcendence going over to the other side.
Right. Yeah, no, so that's a big reason why that documentary resonated with me, because it's, in a lot of ways, it parallels a lot of the work that a lot of good people are doing in the truth community and the alternative research community, you know, where most of us started in jobs and careers and lives that were entrenched in the matrix. You know, we lived a matrix life. We're on the hamster wheel. And many have realized that being connected back to spirit is a very large variable in being able to really break through and see through this matrix and to really take it to the next level. This is why I had a conversation I was on the Charlie Freak Show, I guess about a week ago or so. And Charlie asked me a similar question. And I said to him, the problem that some people in the truth community have, and they're good people, is that they are not connected in spiritually. They don't make any acknowledgement to that. I mean, or if they do, it's very cursory. And the problem with that approach is, you know, the football field is 100 yards. If you don't understand the metaphysical and the spiritual piece of what it is that we're doing, the work that we're doing, then you're only going to be able to run that ball to the 50-yard line. That's it, half the field. Because there's another 50 yards that you don't even know exists. And in order to complete the picture, you have to do both. You have to have an understanding of what's going on around us in the physical world. And you also have to understand that there is a whole other world, a whole other existence outside of this physical world that plays a very important part in our consciousness, in our ability to see truth. And for me, that's the spiritual aspect of it.
And I totally agree. I mean, the only thing I may disagree is I'm not even sure they get to 50 yards, if I'm really honest. I think in terms of mind the gap, we're talking about this question of the threshold. And that's an early experience of the hero's journey. So that's something what, you know, that's like an early step in the journey. So, and I think people just don't, this consciousness spiritual journey. It's interesting. I was on a course this weekend with a chaplain talking about spirituality and therapy. And some of the things I was bringing up for him just went totally above his head. It was just like, he didn't have a clue what I was talking about. This, you know, the real detachment, negation, the letting go of all the things that matter to you and having to make sense of it while you're doing that and still live within the matrix, as you say.
Yeah, a lot of people don't understand it. And you know, the folks that are religious people, you know, I'm not knocking religion, but like I've always said, religion is not spirituality. Spirituality is not religion. It's not. Some like to equate it. They think it's one in the same and it's interchangeable. And from my vantage point, my perspective, it is not. It's not interchangeable. So very good intentioned people, pastors, priests, and so on, what they're doing is they're kind of semi-plugged in, because the religions that they are espousing, they're man-made. They're man-made. They were given to humankind. And I'll pick on Christianity as an example, because I was a Roman Catholic, and I also, at a point in my life, I was attending an evangelical church. So the holy books and so on, and I'm sure I'm going to annoy a lot of people with this comment, but they're man-made. All you need to do is to do some, you know, some deep research, which I did. I studied the Bible for over 3 years. You can only walk away after really examining it and understanding the true history about the Roman church, that you can get a feel for what it is that was given to us. And so the good folks, the pastors, and like I said, the ministers and the priests that are using the Bible as the basis for spirituality, well, it's not a complete guide. And I've always said, you know, the teachings of Jesus are very important, but even those teachings were cherry-picked by the church. You know, the church cherry-picked. There were many, many gospels. There's not just four gospels. There were many, there were dozens and dozens of gospels that were out there at the time, and the church decided that they were going to use the four that they put into the New Testament. So you have to ask yourself, okay, so if there were many, many, many gospels out there, why is it that those four were chosen? So that's the thing, they were chosen. It's not like God came down and said, I'm going to put those four gospels into the Bible. They were chosen by man, by an elite class, by a ruling class, and that's what was going to go into their holy book. So I don't want to digress too much here, Kevin, because some people are really not going to like what I'm saying. But, you know, like I said, I've been there. So I'm not talking from somebody who's never walked that road. I've walked it. So I feel like maybe I can say a little something about it.
I think initially when you said it, I immediately come to mind. My mum and dad wouldn't like it because they're staunch Irish Roman Catholics as well. So,
yeah.
But that, in a way, their relationship with religion and spirituality is the reason why I struggle with it, because for me, they sort of use it as a third party. They don't really do the work. They just use it as a traditional sort of way to say they're with faith and they're with God, but they don't do the spiritual journey. The spiritual journey is really, really, it's a really, really hard journey. And that's why most people won't take it.
Yeah, that's exactly right. That's a very good point. So what happens is the spiritual journey is something that you actually have to do. You have to interact. You have to make it happen. So, which means you have to personally connect into it. And so what happens a lot of times with religions is that people are not really connected into it. Their idea of being connected is I go to church every Sunday. And then once Mass is over, and I'll speak in terms, because like I said, I was a Roman Catholic for many, many years, born and bred, right? And once church was over, you know, 1 o'clock in the afternoon on Sunday, then it was, you went about being you, doing whatever it is that you do, good, bad, or indifferent, until next Sunday, and you showed up again. And basically, it became this kind of, it's almost like a ritualistic type of approach to spirituality. And of course, that's not spirituality. That's rote behavior. And that's conditioning and programming, thinking that if I do this, all is forgiven. I'm okay. I'm meeting some obligatory or perfunctory type of requirement that's been put on me to do these things. And as long as I do it, everything's good.
Yeah. And as long as you confess to the priest and he sends you away with a couple of Hail Marys and Hail Fathers, everything's fine. I just used to be gobsmacked with the hypocrisy of the behavior to the authority figure, as in the priest, and how they behave to you as parents. It's such a contrast. And they were terrified of the priests and the nuns.
Well, I remember as a kid being very uncomfortable in church because of all of the ritual and the robes and, you know, and the candles and the altar and all of this stuff. When you think about it, then the communion and the Eucharist, eat my body, drink my blood. It's like, I remember as a kid thinking to myself, this is very weird. I couldn't really put my finger on it. And these are mental thoughts I was having. I really couldn't voice it with my parents because it would not go over well, you know. And I just thought the whole thing was just very odd, you know. And it is odd when you think about it. And I never liked going to confession because as a Roman Catholic, you sit in this booth and, you know, you're telling some hidden person, and he's hidden. You're not even talking to him face to face, right? There's kind of a veil there about your sins. And like you said, he tells you to say, you know, say this many Hail Marys and so on, and you're going to be okay. And I remember thinking to myself, as even as a young kid, I'm talking like, you know, 12, 13, 14 years old. I'm like, well, who does he tell his sins to? I mean, don't tell me he doesn't sin.
He's got direct connection to God, hasn't he?
Yeah. He's got the hotline. He just picks the phone up, you know?
So, just rings him up and tells him.
It's crazy. It's crazy. And so what happened was, like, by the time I was 17 years old, as soon as I was able to drive, I'll tell this story. So my brother and I, he's only a year and a half younger than I am, and we were on the same page with all of this. And so when I was 17, I was able to drive. I had my driver's license. And so we would wake up And we would tell my parents that we were going to early mass because my parents always went to later mass. And what we did instead was we went to a diner and we had breakfast. And then we would come home and, you know, they would say, well, hey, so how was mass? Like, oh, it was great. It was great. It was really just superb, you know. It didn't resonate with me anymore. And I remember when I was 12, 11, 12, 13 years old, it really kind of seemed creepy to me, the whole ritual and the liturgy. And then when I reached, you know, 16, 17 years old, I just didn't want any part of it anymore. And what's interesting, I went a very long time, Kevin, you know, not plugged into religion, into the church. And then, oh, I don't know, maybe about a decade ago, I found myself going to an evangelical fundamentalist church here in Raleigh. The people were great. And this, I want to make this clear to everybody because I don't want to make it sound like I'm just bashing. I'm not bashing. The fellowship, like within the church itself, is exceptional. People are very kind. You know, when people need help, for the most part, they step up, they help, they see what they can do. They did a lot of really good things for the youth as far as youth camps and barbecues and just fostering that fellowship. So that part I thought was great. But I spent 3 years there, and it was because of a relationship that I was in. And I said, well, you know what, let me give this another shot and let's see. But I struggled, you know, even though for 3 years or so, 4 years I was there, it did not resonate with me, you know, and I was at a point where I was tolerating it. I was just tolerating it because I wanted to be supportive to my partner at the time. And then after that, I just decided that, you know, this is just not for me.
Yeah. And I can resonate with that. There's a part of that. I think of my extended family still go now. I'm not sure they go for themselves. I think they go to please the elders or the parental structure. And that's why I think they go. And maybe that's the bit I still struggle with. And that was the thing about the film as well, that the thing that really struck me at the beginning of the film was, this sense of community. There's shots of these neighborhoods and villages all on the street and being together and being quite socially conscious together around the Beatle concept. And I thought about just where we are now in terms of how that's all been broken up and that sort of social cohesion doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah, we don't have any social cohesion. And Max Egan had a saying, putting common unity back into community. We don't have that anymore. The matrix, the controllers, I call them the controllers, their agenda is to break up the community aspect of it. It's to break up the family component, break up the community. Because when people have a sense of community and a sense of family, there's a lot of strength there. You can rely on each other. You back each other up. You have each other's backs. You take care of each other. The young take care of their elders and so on. So this is, you know, it's very communal. And we have been programmed, or I should say society and the culture has been programmed to believe that that is something that is just weird. That's just strange to have that sense of community and to have such strong ties that you really need to be out on your own. That's why they said, hey, by the time your kids are like 18, 19 years old, you should kick them out of the house and they should be out and, you know, fending for themselves and so on. And we take our elders and our parents and our grandparents and, you know, we put them in homes and stuff like that to be cared for. So everything has become very segmented and everybody is out there on their own. It's like every man for himself, basically, because they can't have cohesion. Because if people come together, then they realize that they don't need this oligarchy. We don't need this overlord apparatus that is just hanging over us. They will lose their control and they won't be able to sell or push their agenda because there would just be pushback. People would just say, we don't need this. I understand what you're telling me and I know what you're asking me to adopt, but I'm not going there. So in order to get rid of that, they had to just break it all up and, like I said, get rid of the community aspect of it, the family aspect of it.
And they've done a fantastic job, unfortunately. And I suppose that's what we need to work on is getting back to numbers. And in numbers, it gives people courage to actually start speaking out and start expressing themselves and having that sense of an identity they can share with a group instead of this force identity. I mean, I don't know where you are, but I'm in the UK and the repression and suppression is just, it's just tremendous at the moment.
Yeah, it's pretty much the same here. Because of the blog and the radio shows, I mean, I get a taste for what goes on in the UK, out in Europe. Australia is really bad. In the United States, you know, there is this semblance of more freedom, but you really don't have freedom. People think of freedom in terms of you're able to, you know, leave your home or your apartment and you can go shopping. You know, you could do something like that, but you really don't have, you don't have freedom. If you have to have a license to drive, you're not free. In the United States, in many communities, you have to have a license for your dog. You have to, you know, we have marriage licenses. You have to have a license to get married. Just think in those terms. Here in the States, we have property tax. So in all 50 states, Kevin, property tax is, it's basically, it's a lien against your land. So if you buy your home and you have a piece of property, the state taxes your property every single year. And if you do not pay that property tax, they will take your land and they will take your home. Even if you own your home outright, let's just say you pay your mortgage off, you still have to pay the property taxes. Property tax is a perpetual lien on your land. You can never own your land, which means you're a tenant. Well, what does that mean? It means we're still in the feudal system. That's what it means. And, but you know, when you try to explain this to people, some people get it. Others will defend the matrix. They go into playing defense for them and will say, well, you know, we need property taxes because if we don't have property taxes, this won't get paid for and that won't get paid for. And, you know, our schools are very important and so on. And my point is, well, then why don't they just bill us? In other words, instead of putting a lien on my property, why don't you send me an invoice every year like they do with my water utility or my electrical utility? Do it that way. Why are you putting a lien? The reason why they're putting a lien on our property is because they own the property, but they can't come out and say, we own your property, because they want you to think you own it. They want you to think that you're free. They want you to think that you're sovereign and independent. So what they do is they have this little scam going. It's a gimmick. They package it by saying, this has to get done, because if it doesn't get done, we're not going to have the money for the roads and the schools and all that other stuff that you guys enjoy. You like that stuff, right? You like to have nice roads, even though we don't have nice roads. And people nod, you know, yes, like good robots. And that's how they get away with it. They camouflage it. They're very good at camouflaging their oppression. It's unfortunate, but huge, huge swatches of the population buy into it.
Yeah, and we have a classic example of that coming up pretty soon in the UK with this royal wedding, where people don't understand that the Queen actually owns the land your house is on, and at any time she can take it back. And they, you know, I should never do that. She's lovely, and she's this sort of person. And I work in broadcast TV, and the people, they're so excited about it. It's mind-boggling sometimes.
I have to tell you, as an American looking at Britain and the whole royal family thing, I don't get it. I just don't get it. And they just fawn over them. And, you know, having now the baby, right? They're going to have a baby now. And that's on the front cover of the tabloid magazines here and in our supermarkets. And people are just, they're glued to that stuff. And they'll watch whatever ceremonies are on television. And I'm thinking to myself, you are praising the very people that are oppressing you. It's just absolutely, what do they call it? Stockholm syndrome, yeah, where you,
you know, it's not any oppression. These people have been the most barbaric, murderous, raping families you could ever imagine in the history of the world. And they're waving flags at them.
Yeah. 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 It's really, I don't know. It really says something about the human psychology. It really does. And it also tells us, Kevin, why getting the truth out there and getting people to have a shift in their thinking and their consciousness is a very difficult job. It's very, very difficult, because they are trying to pollute the minds of the masses 24/7, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year in perpetuity. They just keep going with it. And they know they have to do that because if they ever let up, the natural inclination of the human is to start to get back into your natural state. And once you start moving more into your natural state, which means you're critically thinking and free thinking, you're going to question a lot of things. So in order to keep you from questioning, in order for you to even take one step back into your natural normal state of existence, they continue to bombard us with this nonsense. And, you know, so it's always out there. It's always out there. And if it's not the media, it's what they're putting in your foods. It's what they're spraying in the skies. It's the fluoride in your water. It's the aspartame in your drinks. And it's all of that stuff, you know? So when you take a look at it, it's a full spectrum attack on humanity. You know, a lot of times people like to just call it's just the media and all that stuff. I'm like, well, it's the media is a huge piece of it. Don't get me wrong, but they have their tentacles into everything, everything.
And I think also me as a therapist, I think the thing it's not talked about a lot is emotionally they get us between 0 and 7. They've got the setup, so they've got the mechanism, the engineering in place where we talk about in TA this choice between a free child and adapted child, and they know how to make us become adapted at a very early age, the social constructs. And then once we're into that mode, our thinking's based on that emotional underbelly, and that's when we start making decisions, because to go back, that fear gets reenacted in the child if they go against that decision.
Yeah, everything that they do is based in fear and scarcity. So you have to be fearful and things have to be scarce. So when we say things have to be scarce, as an example, here in the U.S., people who have their jobs are always under the gun that they may get let go, laid off. They're gonna lose their jobs. Scarcity would be you can't pay your mortgage. Scarcity would be that you don't make enough money to be able to make your car payments. So it's, you know, it's all based in that. And when you take a step back and you understand that those are the two primary components of how this works, you know, when people are fearful and they have a sense that things are scarce or they're not going to be able to be able to make it, get to the next day, living paycheck to paycheck, you are in survival mode. You're not thriving. So they don't want anybody thriving. So they're going to keep you in that root chakra, and they're going to keep you right down there and keep you in a very, very base survival mode and ensure that you worry about everything or just about everything in your life. But am I going to have enough food? Am I going to have my job? Am I going to be able to afford medical care? And so on and so on. This is what they do. And it's got really, it has the population, especially in the Western world, paralyzed. It really does for the most part. Most people live like this. They're very fearful of everything around them. I mean, here in the US, I'm sure it's the same in the UK, you watch the news, nothing ever good comes out of the news. There's never anything good that happens in the world. Everything is bad. Everything is something you have to worry about. You know, my parents, you know, they're in their 80s and they sit there and they watch the Fox News channel and everything is about terrorism and alerts and, you know, shootings and stuff like this. And because they're older, I'm not going to be, you know, Mike Sage of Quay and start interrogating them. You know, you have to have this level of kindness because they are older and they are probably at a point where they're just not going to get it. But you can see what this machine, this apparatus is doing to them. I could see this. See, I don't worry about these things because I know most of this stuff, virtually all of it, is all propaganda. It's made up. It's all engineered and staged. So I don't worry about it. I don't walk around my life being worried or fearful. But there are many people like my parents who are. And it's really, when you think about it, Kevin, it's very twisted to do this to people. And it makes you really wonder who these beings are that are at the top of the pyramid. I mean, are they human? I don't know.
And I think that's a really important component because I think maybe you have to get to that point where you can really let that shadow aspect of people or this person being and out there who's doing this, the level of the evil, the level of the control, the level of the propaganda. I think that's the real resistance where people just won't believe. They just won't accept that that's a possibility and that's what's going on.
No, that's exactly right. Because when you have conversations with people and then you start to talk about this stuff, they look at you and they say, well, why would they do that? Well, why would the government want to hurt me? Why would the government want to make vaccines dangerous? Vaccines are not dangerous, Mike. Vaccines are good for you. Vaccines, they keep people from from catching diseases and getting sick and so on. So what the controllers do, Kevin, is they know that humans are very trusting by nature. We are. We're very trusting by nature. Nobody wants to go around their life, or I should say go about their life, believing that people are lying to them almost all the time. Nobody wants to believe that. It's just a very weird, uncomfortable way to live. And when we do have people in our lives that do lie to us, what do we usually do? Well, we call them on it and or we detach from them, right? Because this is not something that's good to be plugged into. So when we're associating with somebody that has been lying or has been engaged in deceptive behavior, we take a step back from it. And many times, like I said, we turn to and walk the other way. Like, okay, I don't need this in my life. So if people became aware that this is exactly what's going on with the government is that same person that you walked away from who was lying and being deceptive. What happens is cognitive dissonance sets in, first of all. They can actually see something bad and then think in terms of it's not that bad. That's the cognitive dissonance aspect of it. And I see this all the time. So people want to believe that people, including people in the government and people running the governments, are good, that they're actually looking out for you and, you know, they're doing things that are going to benefit you. They don't want to think in terms of, you know, that they're being deceived or screwed every single day.
And I sort of see it as being like a perpetual child. It's like this child is like, so what's the alternative if it is this government is like this? What do I have to do? Oh my God, that means I might have to take some responsibility. That means I might have to start being an individual and having my own ideas and concepts in the world. And I'm not sure if I like that or where I sit with that. And I'll tell you what, I'll just go back and listen to the news.
Yeah. Well, what happens is they feel comfortable, even though they're in the matrix. They are comfortable with being there because they believe that they understand it and know it, even though what they believe they understand and know is fiction. It's nothing more than propaganda. It's a story that's being given to you. It has no semblance in truth, but people, they just get comfortable with it. You know, it's like the person that has a job that they can't stand. Every day to go to work, they don't like their job. And they talk about, you know, I have to find another job. It probably would be good if I found some different work. But most people don't do it because it's like, well, even though I don't like it here, I know the process. I know my job and, you know, and change is just so, it's upheaval in my life. And people don't want all that change, right? So they'll stay put. They'll stay put even in a situation that is really not healthy for them. Because they think that even though it's not really that healthy for me, I know how to navigate it. And I think that that's the implied thinking of a lot of people that are in the matrix. You know, they see parts of it clearly that are not healthy or that are not good for them, but they sit there and it continue to play along because, like you said, to think outside the box means that you're going to have to take responsibility. You're going to have to do something. You are going to have to do something differently, not the next guy, not somebody doing it for you. You have to do it. And most people, the fact that they have to do something, which means that they have to think, put into play, implement, that scares them because they feel like, I don't think I know how to do this and do this. And by the way, what if I fail? It's that whole fear of failure aspect that comes into play in this thing. But the thing is, you know, there is no failure. There's learning. And the thing is, you are going to fall on your face every once in a while. I mean, it's just, that's the way it is. And you just get up off your knees and you know, you right yourself and you move forward and you learn from the experience. But I'll tell you, most people don't really, really don't want change. They get too comfortable with the status quo.
Well, the change is too fearful. If I think of my, you know, when I was going through my journey and my awakening, you know, to lost loads of friends, you lose your family unit, you have to really contend with the extended family, the pressures of that and the betrayal, the sense of being scapegoated and being this perpetual bad object. You really need to dig deep and start learning an inner strength and really starting to understand yourself to be able to deal with that level of discomfort and ostracization as well.
Yeah, you have to know your audience. When you're in the business that you're in and I'm in, you have to know your audience. So, you know, Years back, I would be more direct about information that I've come across, the research and so on, and I would express it to family and friends, thinking falsely that they would find it as interesting as I did, only to find out that there was just this tremendous pushback. And it caused a lot of stress in the family, you know. In fact, on my current album, Hollow Moon, I wrote a song called Black Sheep. And Black Sheep is a song that I wrote. It wasn't for me directly. It was for all the people that are doing the types of work that you're doing and I'm doing and many others in alternative research and in the truth community. We become the black sheep of our family circles or circles with our friends and so on. So I had to come to grips with the fact that when I'm with certain groups of people, namely my family and friends, because I love them, you know, I mean, they're my family and my friends. I don't want to stand out there being ostracized because I'm going to try to make a point or stand on principle. I have principles, but one of my principles is that I love my family and I'm not going to isolate. So we just don't talk about certain things. It's as simple as that. And some people might say, oh, that's a cop out. You should always be talking about this stuff. And I disagree. You know why I disagree? Because as I've mentioned, I tried that approach and it does not work very well. So, you know, the thing is with this work is that it's reaching one person at a time, Kevin. It really is. And some of those people might be people in your family. They might be friends of yours or maybe not, but it's one person at a time. That's really how it is. It's a very incremental, methodical process. And to think that this big tidal wave of conscious awakening is just going to sweep over the world and everything is going to be a panacea next week or a year from now, that's not realistic thinking.
No, and I totally agree. And I think you highlighted to me very two distinct stages of this journey. When you were saying, I remember when I started waking up and I started reading, I was sharing this information, I was running around and I was ecstatic and you were just getting these blank looks, or you clear tables quicker than you could imagine, and that sort of aspect. But and part of the process is to learn. You have to really learn discernment. You really have to learn this ability to. You can't force people to wake up. You can only sort of sow seeds. You can give out information, or as you said, you just accept where people are on their journey, or not even started their journey.
That's the key. It's where they're at, you know, and I have seen some change in folks that I know that were completely, you know, hands off Mike, you know, he's crazy. Over the years, I've started to see them now evolve closer and closer to many of the things that I have been talking about over the years. And the reason is because the controllers now have put so many restraints in play. As far as restrictions of rights and liberties and stuff like that, that I always said that when this stuff starts to roll up on your front doorstep, and now it starts to become more personal, you will begin to wake up. See, a lot of people don't wake up because they fall back and say, "Well, this doesn't affect me." That's really a shame, but it's really none of my business, and I don't see it happening in my neighborhood or. In my town or my state and so on. And so they just dissociate from it. It has no impact on them. And that's because they don't understand that the process that the controllers have is also incremental. It's little by little, step by step. I think David Icke calls it the, what does he call it? The tyrannical?
Totalitarian and tiptoe, isn't he?
Over tiptoe, right. Yeah. So, and he's absolutely right. David's absolutely right. That's how they do it. Because if they try to do things too quickly, people would be like, oh, wait a minute, hold on, right? That becomes more obvious. But by doing it step by step, very methodically, over time, people just assimilate it, they adapt, they adopt, and that becomes their way of life. And it just becomes a whole lot easier for the controllers.
And for me, you know, I see it very much. If you watch like an emotional abuser or a narcissist, and you see how they gradually change the behavior of their victims or preys, it's they use the same techniques and strategies which the controllers are using on us. And I think that's what we need to be doing. We need to be understanding our emotionality and how we're influenced emotionally, and then we can start understanding what they're actually doing to us.
Yeah, well, that's a very important point, Kevin, that you're making here. The controls have spent enormous amounts of time, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years, understanding the human psyche. They know how humans operate. They know how we think. They know how we respond to things. They know how to predict behavior. They know how to do these things. So there's a lot of research and a tremendous amount of science that has gone into them understanding the human mind. They will do things, clearly, knowing that it's going to elicit a certain response. And they are like narcissists. They're going to tell you what you want to hear, but they're going to go do whatever it is that they were going to go do as part of their agenda. So what they'll do is they'll tie in the lies and the deception. They'll tell you what you want to hear so that you're agreeable to it. And then that is married to a direction in which they want to go. So what happens then is that now there's compliance. Now you're complying to the change. And I realize that it's a lie and it's deceptive the way they're doing it, but that's how it works. They will deceive you into complying, and the deception involves their understanding of human behavior. So as an example, staged events and false flags, right? They know that staged events and false flags, what's going to happen? It's going to elicit an emotion of fear in people and not feeling comfortable with their safety and their security. And that's normal. Back when we lived in tribal types of communities, if you came under attack, there would be fear. And, you know, you want to preserve the safety and the sanctity of your family and your tribe. So that's something that's inbred in our DNA. So they take that and they inflict that fear. They put it in your mind. Then they turn around and tell you, we completely understand why you're fearful. So we're going to protect you. We're going to make sure that you're safe. We're going to make you safe. You may have to give up a couple of things. Like, you may have to give up some rights to be safe, but isn't that okay? Wouldn't you rather be safe and alive than have your rights and be dead? I mean, that's really what they're saying to us. So they play that game all the time. It's really what it is. It's psychological warfare.
Yeah, totally. And as you said, it's this constant traumatizing of people's perceptions and concepts. And the thing I always find fascinating when I listen to yourself and other podcasters in this realm is I'm not sure sometimes how divorced you are from people in sometimes my reality at work. And as a training therapist, we do things like group process. And to even mention something like a false flag, it would just be like, whoa. What are you on about? That's absolute madness. And these are people who have done 4 or 5 years of therapy, you know, where they're meant to be opening up their mind and being having a different level of awareness. But even the slightest thing outside of the box, and you start mentioning the matrix or people controlling you, it's just beyond their comprehension.
Yeah, it is beyond their comprehension because they have been taught and indoctrinated and propagandized to believe that the world is a certain way. And so what they do is they put people in fish tanks or fish bowls, right? And this becomes your world. So, I mean, it would be like going, if you were able to communicate with a fish in a fish tank and say, hey, by the way, you're in a fish tank and there's a whole nother world out here. The fish would look at you and say, no, there isn't. This is the world right here. It's, you know, it's where I'm swimming. Don't tell me there's another world because this is what I experience every day. This is what I see. And this is what it looks like. So don't be telling me stuff that are falsehoods. If you ever watched the movie, The Truman Show is really telling us that your reality is completely fabricated, that you have people pulling the strings and they have you in that proverbial fishbowl and you don't know it. You think that this is the world and you think this is the way it operates. It goes back to what we were saying before. You talk about false flags and people like, oh no, that's because in their world, they have been told that the government and your elected representatives would never do anything like that. They never engage in any kind of behavior or activity that would be detrimental to your best interests. And they accept that.
And as you said earlier, all their feelings, all their inner intuition is telling them something's wrong. Yet there's still massive refusal to look at it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. I've had conversations with people about that very topic. You know, I'll listen to them and they'll say something and I'm listening and I'm thinking, okay, well, you know, you're down the right path. And so when you say, well, you just said this. And based upon what you just said, I mean, wouldn't that make you start to at least think that maybe something else is at play here? Wouldn't you just even kind of just consider it? And as soon as you start to lead them down that path, many people will just shut it off. They bring themselves back, and that's that. Nope, nope. I had a lack of judgment or whatever at that point, or I misspoke. And so I'm going to bring myself back, and I'm going to be right here, centered in where I want to be. Makes me happy to be here. Now, don't be screwing with my head, Mike. So, you know, it's very interesting, Kevin, in a lot of ways, to be going through this time in history that you and I are going through, and to watch all of this. Because if you had come to me 10 years ago and had said that I would be doing this work, or I would be looking at the world the way I'm looking at it today, I would have thought you were crazy.
Yeah, no, I totally agree. And it's only for like people like yourselves, the pioneers who are putting the information out and are taking a risk. We're all taking a risk by speaking out and sharing. It can set us even more into isolation, away from people. I think of a lot of my work in telly is, if you're not playing in this social ritual, if you're not playing in this pastime and of being interested in what people are meant to be interested in, you can add to your isolation as well.
Yeah, well, let me give you a couple of examples of isolation and through censorship with me, right? So I've had this ongoing battle where they give me community guideline strikes for shows where people sit down and we have intelligent adult-like conversation about events that are going on in the world. Evidently, we're not allowed to have coherent discussion among adults to talk about issues. And I won't say what those are here because I don't want your show to get censored. I have a problem with my blog where Google has essentially turned the blog off in Europe. What they do, they just turn it off, Kevin. And I can see the analytics. I can see where I was. I had a very large viewership in France. And in the UK and other countries in Europe, but France and UK were very, very, the blog was very popular there. I mean, they just turned it off. They turned it off because there was certain content on that blog that they did not want going out into Europe. And I know what that content is, right? The content had to do with Zionism. No way, no way. So the simple solution was, we're just going to turn Mike's blog off there. We'll have views go out there, but it's going to be turned down significantly. And they turned it down significantly on me. I've had situations where I posted some stuff on my Facebook page. I had posted one interview, and it was with Matt McKinley, who used to have the channel Texas Shrugged. I went to go post it, Kevin, and I get this dialogue box that comes back on Facebook and says, does this post contain hate speech? There was no hate speech. I never have hate speech, you know? All of my shows have to do with just sitting down and having intelligent conversation. And there was recently, there was another situation where another dialogue box came up on Facebook asking, is this post, does it have something to do with this or that, whatever. I forgot what it was. But so this is what they're doing now. I mean, so now certain people are certainly on the radar. Ole Damegaard, I'm sure you know who Ole is. I've had him on my show many times, right? He's on their radar. So I'm absolutely convinced that within their search algorithms, the name Ole Damegaard is there. And anything that goes up that has to do with Ole, it's going to be flagged.
Yeah, and I listened to your recent one. We've done it. You know, Ollie's done a great job in connecting dots. And I think that's what they're most fearful of, where if we're connecting dots and I think if we give the information out in pockets, that's fine for them. But if we start connecting the dots and start where people can start seeing this continuous theme, I think that's when they start getting scared and want to start censoring everybody.
Yeah, well, what was interesting with the show that they censored with Ollie was we were talking about Florida. That's all I'll say.
Yeah.
And then Ollie had said that based upon the clues that he had picked up, that there was going to be some event in Texas on or about March 18th. Lo and behold, on or around March 18th, we had the situation in Texas where there was these bombs that were going off in Austin, Texas. Now, Ollie has done this before with some other clues he's picked up, and he has predicted upcoming events. So as you mentioned, little pockets of stuff, very isolated, they don't care about that. But if you start connecting the dots and you start to pick up the patterns and you understand where they're going to go next, that is not going to be allowed. That becomes extremely problematic for them.
And I mean, that's the other thing. I mean, the idea, I speak, you know, when you speak to the, what you call, I think Joe Atwell calls them normies. I quite like that name. It's quite a nice name. You know, when you start speaking around censorship and this is happening to certain people, there seems to be this, well, they deserved it and they should be posting that sort of stuff. So that's another sort of thing we need to contend with, where they're so conditioned in terms of what they're meant to believe or not believe is another really major obstacle for all of us.
Yeah. So what I tell folks is that, or I try to, I shouldn't say tell, but what I try to explain to folks is that humans have been what I refer to as artificially intelligent. So they keep talking about the AI. So, you know, to the average person, the AI means that you're going to have a robot that's going to mow your lawn, right? But no, artificial intelligence is the average human. They have been artificially intelligent. They are programmed. And part of that programming is to defend the AI. It's to defend the Borg. That's what it is. So what do I mean by that? So it's like you just said, when we bring up certain topics, a vast majority of the population will say, oh, he deserves to have his channel taken down. He deserves to be censored. He deserves to have his blog turned off in Europe. That is the programming that people have. It gets triggered. It gets triggered by, oh, he's talking about this. Fine. Now what we got to do is we have to push back and we have to defend the controlling apparatus. People don't want to hear this. And many people will just say, no, I'm not programmed. I'm not conditioned. Yes, you are, because you are inhibiting critical thinking. You are inhibiting free thought. If I was a kook or you were a kook, then what would happen is we might have a following of, you know, a small minority of people that are kooky. We wouldn't have much of an audience. And nobody would be listening to us for all intents and purposes. The fact that there is a larger and larger following of the alternative research and truth community worldwide says that we're not a bunch of kooks, or most of us. I mean, we have kooky fringe aspects of it also, but you know what I'm saying, right? So if we weren't making an impact and we weren't waking people up and we weren't making people think outside the box, they wouldn't censor me. Do say whatever you want to say, have your shows, knock yourself out. But the fact that they're going after certain people says to me that those certain people are putting information out there that they do not want out there and they do not want it to be discussed.
And when, I think it's really important. I think it might have been Sophia who mentioned, we say AI. I think she had this concept of IA, where we were talking about us being conditioned as human beings. And that's a concept I find fascinating, but people still don't understand how conditioned and programmed they are.
No, they don't understand it. And it's because you're born and bred into this realm, into this quote unquote reality, Kevin. And from the day you're born, it starts. This is how wicked it is. It's not like, you know, they catch you when you're like 15 and then they try to mold your head, even though at 15 they are molding your head. But think about it. I mean, when I was a kid, my mother didn't work. My mother stayed at home. She cared for the family. My dad went out and worked. Today, what happens is a baby is born. Both parents are working here in the States. Both parents have to work in order to have any semblance of a lifestyle. So mom gets pregnant, mom has a baby, mom gets 6 weeks of maternity leave. That's it. You get a month and a half and then you get your butt back to work. So then what happens? Well, then who's going to care for the baby? You have to have some kind of babysitter or somebody, a nanny to come in. Maybe the child reaches a certain age and now they're going to preschool. There's after school. So what's happening is the child actually becomes a ward of the state or the ward of somebody else, other than the biological parents. And so, you know, and then the kids are getting all of these vaccines. By the time they're like 4 or 5, they've been injected 50 or 60 times with these vaccines. The food is all processed and GMO'd. They're drinking water with fluoride in it. They're breathing air that's either they're spraying every single day. I live in Raleigh, North Carolina, as many of your listeners probably know. They spray here, Kevin, just about every single day. And God knows what it is that they're spraying. I mean, we know that they have strontium, barium, and aluminum in the spray. But I've also read studies where they've tested it and they've picked up lithium. I mean, give me a break. So my point being is that, you know, we are being bombarded with this stuff from the very beginning. And that's why it's very tough for people to break the code, because, you know, if fluoride, as an example, is lowering the average IQ by 10 points, that's a lot. That's a lot. I was watching a show recently, a documentary. Actually, it was a radio show, maybe about a month ago. I just happened to stumble upon it on YouTube. And there were these three guys that were on. And one guy was, he had to do with IQ testing. And he was saying that the average IQ in the United States is 98. Now, for those that don't know, 98 is a very low number. 98 is not a high IQ. And that's the average IQ in the United States. So if you have a bunch of people walking around on average with a 98 IQ, and I'm not trying to be funny here, but you are not going to get a bunch of people that are going to be free thinking and critical thinking. They're going to essentially, they're going to do what they're told to do. And they're going to follow. They're going to pick a leader, a shepherd, good, bad, or indifferent, and they're going to fall in line. I mean, that's why in the U.S., I think the average IQ of a police officer is something like 105. And it was a case in Pennsylvania going back about maybe about a decade ago. I could be a little wrong on the date there, where there was a guy that sued one of the police departments out of Pennsylvania. I don't think it was Philadelphia, but it was in Pennsylvania. He was rejected because his IQ was too high.
Yeah, I actually believe they actually do personality traits in terms of psychopathic tendencies or sort of some of them traits or some of these police to being part of the police force and stuff like that in terms of agreeableness and sort of maybe some sort of narcissism or just propensity to conformity. So yeah, they're doing a lot of psychological tests for a lot of these groups, and that's a really good example. So you know, the IQ, if we can monitor that over years and we can see it's coming down, that's not by coincidence. But people still won't accept the facts that's happening.
No, and I posted an article on my blog, I guess about 2 weeks ago, where it said that 60-something% of high school students in the United States are at an unacceptable level of reading and math. Almost 2/3 of the high school populations in the United States are at a level that is unacceptable, which means they can't read, or they're not reading at a level that they're supposed to, and they can't do math. So what does this tell you about your society? You know, and this is something that everybody needs to be concerned about. But the problem is that people who should be concerned are not concerned because they don't know any better. They're not looking at anything that's concerning them. They just think, well, this is just the way it is.
And I think ultimately, as you said, at the moment, it doesn't affect them. I mean, the way I look at this is like with the advancements in technology and the way it's moving at such a prolific rate, what are you going to be doing with all these people? You're going to have no need for them operating at this level of IQ. And what are you going to do with them? They're not just going to just keep perpetually feeding them and sustaining them with this technology developments. And you know, we have all these debates at the moment where we're allowing people to come in and with lower IQs, mixing with people with higher IQs, and that's not allowing us to create communities where we can have higher IQs and higher levels of consciousness to actually challenge the matrix.
Well, that's right. So you have like the Hunger Games thing going on here, right? So if you take a look at the jobs, the high-paying jobs in the matrix, it requires somebody to have a decent level of intellect to be able to have the jobs, as an example, in the IT industry or the medical industry, pharmaceutical industry. Now, I mean, like I said, these industries are all parcel of the matrix. So what I'm talking about here is, let's just set the truth aspect of it aside for a moment. Let's just say, well, you want to have a decent living. You want to be able to have a decent job and make decent money and be able to have benefits and take care of your family. Well, these jobs require a level of intellect that the vast majority of the population does not have. They don't have. So what happens is you have the haves and the have-nots, and the have-nots are becoming more and more prevalent. More prevalent. Here in the United States, what's happening is many college graduates have taken student loans out to the tune of tens and tens of thousands of dollars, depending upon what your major is. It could be $100,000, $150,000, depending upon what it is that you majored in. And a lot of these college graduates, they are ending up taking jobs in the service industry. They're working in restaurants. They're working at bars. They're working in retail outlets. Now, I don't know. I don't think that your parents sent you to college, or you paid your way, or tried to pay your way through college. Let's say you've got $50,000 or $75,000 in loans. I don't think that the outcome was that you were going to be working in a Walmart or working in a restaurant like an Applebee's here in the United States. I don't think that that was the plan. So then what happens is, I mean, you still have that $50,000 debt hanging over your head, and you're on the hook for that. And one of the things that they do, and I'm sure they do the same thing in Europe, is they work very hard, I should say, to make it difficult for people to keep the water level below the nose. They want to weigh you down in debt. Everything is about is taking on as much debt as possible, because you should be experiencing all the material aspects of the material world. You should have the biggest TV in the world. You should have the best phone. You should have a house much bigger than you need. You should have a car that's much more luxurious than you actually need. And how do you do that? Take loans out. You have credit cards, and people are completely underwater with this stuff.
And it's another great example of social engineering. I've got some younger nieces, and like, so they have this massive debt, but the way they rationalize it is they're never going to earn enough to pay it back. So that's okay. And like, but then that's, you're going to be perpetually kept to this level of income and aspiration. So, you know, you've given over your level of aspiration based on the debt.
That's right. So that goes back to what we were talking about before, keeping you in survival mode. You're never going to thrive, because if you wake up every day and the bills come in and you have to pay your mortgage, or you have to pay your rent, you have a car payment, you have a student loan payment that you have to make, and you have other credit cards and stuff like that. I mean, you're underwater. Okay. And so your instinct is like, oh my God, how am I going to get through this? This is why so many people suffer from stress and depression, Kevin. And I'm sure you see it in your practice. I see it in my practice all the time. People come in, they are completely stressed out. And it's because of the environment that they're in. It's the environment that the matrix has put together, that people have adopted and believe that they have to operate in. Now, everybody has to operate within the matrix to a certain degree. Okay. I don't believe there's any real like living off the grid type of thing. Even if you think you found a plot of land somewhere, you had to get the land from somebody that is connected into the matrix in one way, whether through deeds and banks and stuff like that. But what you can do is you can start disconnecting from their biggest traps, like stay out of the debt game. That's number one. Start eating better food. Don't get yourself vaccinated. Stay away from the flu shots. Filter your water. You know, it's just stuff like that that you can do, and you can lead a better life. Downsize. That's another one. You know, there's neighborhoods here where I live, Kevin, where the houses are so big. And I think to myself, why do you need a 4, 5, 6,000 square foot home? I don't quite understand that. Why is that? It's just you, your wife, and maybe a kid or two. Well, what's that all about? That's the programming that says you're going to be judged at how important you are and how impressive a human being you are based upon your material possessions. And once people start dropping that and getting rid of that stuff, they're going to have a lot less stress in their life.
And I'm very aware of your time. And so I think the film you picked is a really good example of that, because George Harrison actually decided to make that other choice. He decided he was going to go on another route, and he wasn't going to be judged by his materialistic gains and his houses. He actually made that conscious choice. And when I look at that film and the times, I mean, I think it's so accepted around the yogis and Hare Krishna now. I mean, at the time, that must have been really groundbreaking and really puzzling for people, to someone so iconic to go along that route.
Oh, absolutely. There was one news conference that they showed in the documentary where, you know, he was, I think he was up on stage with John Lennon, and it was only the two of them. And there was one guy in the audience from the press, I guess, that was giving him a very hard time, you know, about this whole thing with meditation and all that. And, you know, and George said that because you don't understand it doesn't mean that it's not real. You know, your ignorance is what's feeding your fear or your ridicule of something that you don't understand it. So why don't you try understanding it first and then having a position on it versus having a position with no understanding? And this is, of course, what a lot of people do. They have positions on things that in which they really don't understand, but they'll render an opinion anyway. So yeah, it was a great film. And yeah, I'm glad we circled back to it. I probably digressed there a little bit on some of the stuff, but yeah, no, it's that film to me, it resonated with me, Kevin. That's one of the reasons why I picked it and as a discussion point to start our talk today.
I'd just like to thank you for our conversation and giving me your time. And if you just let the audience know where they can find you, and that would be great.
Yep, it's very easy. All you need to do is I have a hub website. It's Sage, S-A-G-E of Quay, Q-U-A-Y, sageofquay.com. If you go there, you'll be able to hit my blog, my YouTube channel. I have another YouTube channel that has to do with guitar repair, and another site that has to do with my music. My current album, which was released in February, is called Hollow Moon, and there's a link for that. That's it. Just go to the Hub website, and everything is there.
Thank you. Really appreciate it.
You're very welcome, Kevin. Thank you so much.
It's